Hey everyone out there in internet land, this is Jeff Lafferty, and it's time for another Earthcast. Still haven't thought of a name for the show, but that's fine. I'm not sure I'm gonna actually even name it. I think it's just fine for me to say, it's just a VBlog. But anyway, what is it? Episode number 17. Hopefully everybody can hear me talking. I'm doing another late night show, and I should apologize for when this one's going to go up, because I know it's actually not going to go up at the usual, 3 in the morning or whatever. I don't know if anybody's really looking for it at that point anyway. Well, I kind of think it does, because every time when it goes up, it just seems like I immediately get a few hits from people watching it, but, yeah. Just couldn't quite get it all to work out. And now I'm recording it. It's Thursday night, I guess? Yeah, it's Thursday night. Or actually Friday morning. What is it? It's 2:30. Just trying to get this piece finished up. No kind of deadline, it's just for my own personal satisfaction of getting it done. But, obviously it's Cornelius and Zira from Planet of the Apes. And I don't know why I picked this one. I was looking for some Roddy McDowell reference for a commission I'm supposed to be doing here pretty quick. And I don't know, this was something that came up, kind of caught my eye, and I just thought, shoot, I'm going to just go ahead and draw that. It's one thing I like about these drawings is, I can kind of follow my my muse in a way and paint things that I feel like painting. They, it's not so super dependent on whether or not it's going to sell, because they're fast enough that, if a couple doesn't sell, it doesn't matter so much. So this is one I kind of, I'm sure somebody out there could buy it, but it would surprise me if somebody ends up buying it just because it's, an older movie and stuff. But it's going to be so cool that I don't know how people are going to pass it up, really. But it also kind of makes me think that, like, if somebody doesn't buy it, that's totally fine, because I wouldn't mind it if I can just hang on to this one and hang it on my own wall, because I loved the Planet of the Apes movies when I was a kid. I mean, I still love them, but all the originals, I think the first one's probably my favorite is. I was going to say it was the first one. To me, it's the best one, is the first one. Charlton Heston, and it's just such a crazy concept. To me, it's like the Matrix movie in a way. Even though, it wasn't as I didn't see this at the theaters, of course. I saw this on TV. But, looking back on it, I feel like, what a great idea for a movie, And, of course, I love the ending. Which I don't know if the entire movie was wrote. It was adapted from a book, but I know that the movie script or whatever, the screenplay, at one point was rewrote by Rod Steiger. And I'm pretty sure that he was the one who came up with the famous scene in the end where, I see the Statue of Liberty and it turns out to be Earth. I guess spoiler alert if you hadn't seen it. Sorry, I guess I should have said that first. I can't imagine, there's anybody in the whole world that hasn't seen Planet of the Apes. But I mean, to me, that's probably the best one. The one I might like better than that, though, was, I think it was Battle for the Planet of the Apes. It's like the, let's see, the first one's Planet of the Apes. Second one is it Return to the Planet of the Apes? I think so. That's where Charlton Heston's in it for a little bit, but it's a different guy, and they go back, and then there's like the freaky underground people with the brains and all the mind control stuff, which, that, you know, that as a kid, that I hated the mind control stuff, you know. I hated the Star Trek episodes with the mind control. For some reason, it just, that just creeped me out when I was a kid. And that I totally remember, you know, Planet of the Apes. It just, that, I liked that movie, but I didn't like, once they got into the underground city and there's like the creepy people. But I don't know, looking back on it, I like that movie too. But that one was pretty good. Then the next one is Beyond the Planet of the Apes, maybe? It's the one where they come back, or Cornelius and Zira go to like the future where, you know, humans are, and you know, they take off in the rocket right as the planet goes up in the last one, which I remember seeing in a, you know, making a documentary about Planet of the Apes, that they blew up the planet because they were like, you know, they didn't want to even make a sequel, let alone two sequels, and so they were like, we'll blow up the planet and that way we won't have to write another one. And of course, you know, they wanted another one, so they had to figure out, okay, now what do? We just blew up the planet and everybody on it, and how do we fix that? So they sent the chimps into the past, I guess. Past. And, you know, it's kind of like, you know, Apes in New York or whatever. But that one was actually a pretty cool one still. Though you can tell it's like they're getting more low budget at that point. And I think that's one of the reasons, you know, because it's like always, at least back in the 70s, was the best way to, you know, go low, you know, lower the budget on something like that, you know, is always to do the time travel to like the normal world, when they just have to, you know, film it the same place they're filming, like Dallas or whatever, you know what I mean? I mean, all those shows and movies always had that same look, and, you know, I don't know. And that's what that movie looks like. It looks like almost like an episode of Kojak or something, you know? But still a pretty good movie, and it had one of my favorite actors. I can't remember his name. Mr. Rourke from Fantasy Island. And he's like the... Oh, wait a minute, was he? Yeah. No. Or yeah, he is in that. And yeah, in the end, spoiler alert, turn it off if you don't want to hear it. When they have a baby in the future, and they're trying to get the baby, and he takes the baby, he's like a zoo, runs a zoo or something, and he takes the baby, even though these two get killed, which turns out to be Caesar. And then the next one's where the apes are, that might actually be Battle for the Planet of the Apes, I don't know, but the next one's when the apes kind of, you know, it goes forward now, and the apes revolt. You know, the apes are like slaves, basically, and they revolt and take over the city. And I really like that one too. That's another awesome one. And then that one after that, which is like probably one of the least known ones, really. But for some reason, I really like that one, because it's like when the apes, you know, have kind of taken over and they're establishing. Well, kind of overdid it there. They're establishing their world or whatever, and then there's some humans left over. Underground, like always. Underground mutant. Those are like the big bad guys in the 70s, always some kind of underground mutant, you know, radioactive type people. And it's like there's a part I totally remember watching this because my grandma was like a, you know, she just, I don't know, she liked movies and stuff, and I don't know what, I would always be up there, like, she used to stay up super late, which is kind of funny, because I'm, like, the same way, and she lived right next door to us when I was a kid, and, like, I'd look out the window, and the light would be on up there, you know, lived out on a little farm and stuff, she lived right next door, and I'd, you know, go out in the middle of the night, which is pretty crazy, it's like Tristan, you know, getting up in the middle of the night and leaving. And I'd go up there, and she'd be watching TV, and she'd always be like, "Come in, you know." And we'd watch whatever she was watching, and like, you know, all the old movies used to be on at night. They would rerun them. I remember watching, you know, like seeing Frankenstein for the first time, and all that stuff, and. I totally remember going up there one time, and it was Battle for the Planet, or whatever that last one is. I'm not sure if it's Battle for the Planet of the Apes, but and there's like a part where like Caesar, the ape that kind of takes over, which is actually played by Roddy McDowall, I think. I'm pretty darn sure. Kind of comes back and reprises his role there. But his kid gets killed by one of the gorillas. I think the girl's name was Aldo, even. I can't even really remember that. But he accidentally kind of kills the kid because the kid's like listening in on the gorillas, you know, plan. Of course, the gorillas were always sort of planning on, you know, taking over and turning the place into a, you know, martial state or something, you know. And so he accidentally kills the kid and then kind of covers it up. And then in the end, Caesar kind of finds out, and he's like pushing, you know, he's like trying to get to the one gorilla, and the gorilla's kind of going up the tree, you know, he's like the big baddie, tough gorilla, but he's like kind of in fear of the chimp, because he's, you know, the chimp's got so much passion and stuff, you know, he just lost his kid. And all the apes are chanting, you know, ape shall not kill ape, ape shall not kill ape, which was like one of the laws in the movie. It's a good movie, man. Everybody should download that right now and watch it. So, yeah, I don't know, those were, I mean, I don't know, I was such a movie nut when I was a kid, you know. And I still am a little bit, but I don't watch them near as much as I used to. I guess just because I don't have time. I really only watch, you know, TV. Though I do put a movie in sometimes when I'm drawing, but I only really watch TV while we're having dinner. So, and usually if we're having dinner, you know, if we put a movie on, it's like we don't have time to finish it because, you know, Tristan and everybody goes to bed pretty early, and I walk the dog, and, you know, we just don't stay up till like 10 o'clock like we used to when me and Tanya were single, so we usually just end up watching, you know, Hell's Kitchen or something. Somewhere, you know, some reality TV show. But then they start screwing it up. I mean, you know, then they left the franchise and for years and years, and then the Tim Burton one with the Planet of the Apes, which was like the makeup was awesome, but I just thought like movies sucked, and I'm not a Mark Wahlberg fan, and you know, he was in it, and I still honestly don't understand the ending in that. I guess they're trying to do like the ending in the Kirk Douglas one, but to me it's just like it didn't make sense. Like, you know, the chimp flies back to the, you know, Earth, and then somehow he, what, like, starts a revolt, and eventually it's all apes, so that, like, when the other guy comes back later, you know, I don't know, it still just doesn't make sense to me. And so, I don't know, I just didn't like that one. And then I don't know what these new ones are. I actually haven't seen them. I should watch them. But there's something about like the apes. Like I just it's in a way I just don't want to see the CG apes. And I seen them and they look cool and everything. But it's like to me like if I want to see a Planet of the Apes movie, I want these apes because that was what was neat about it, you know. So I don't know. And there's something like I don't know, like the CG apes and the new ones too. They're very like I don't know. They look like uglier than normal apes to me, you know. It's kind of like when they did the new King Kong, you know. They made him so like ugly with his teeth and everything. And I don't know. It just for some reason just didn't like it that well. And I'm a huge Peter Jackson fan and. I mean, I did like it, actually. I did like it as a movie. But, well, there was parts of it I didn't really like. There was parts of it that I just thought looked really fake. Like when they're running from the brontosauruses or whatever. I just thought that just looked so chintzy. And, I don't know. You know, it's like a multi-million dollar movie. You'd think somebody, when they're doing a CG or something, they're would have said, you know, God, this looks so shitty, you know. Went back and filmed or whatever they had to do to make it look better, but it just looks so damn fake, you know. That's one of the things like where I almost like a lot of the old effects better. I mean, like when I'm watching the Avengers and stuff. And I look at those effects, I think, yeah, it's like they're perfect, you know. But then there's sometimes when I'm looking at some of these older, or some effects, and I think that's a good example, where it's like, I'd rather see the old effects, you know. I'd rather see like a stop motion puppet or something, than what they're doing the other way. And I mean, sometimes you see like the older effects and they look even better than, you know, like the new stuff. And, you know, I'm thinking of like Hellboy. If you ever watch the making of that second Hellboy movie, and there's just like a ton of like practical effects in that. And it looked, you know, that was awesome. And a lot of those monsters in that, I mean, to me, they look so much better than even like the Avengers monsters, like the monsters that come through the portal or whatever. I don't know. I mean, if it looks, there's something about CG sometimes that just looks so damn fake, you know. But then I used to think the same thing about the stop motion monsters back in the day. I used to kind of like wince when I would see one coming in and he looked, you know, so herky jerky fake, you know. Now I kind of miss that though. It didn't, I mean, I don't know, it didn't stop me from disliking or liking the movies, well, you know, when I saw the Imperial Walkers or, you know, Luke on the Tauntauns or something, knowing that that was like stop motion, I still thought it was freaking awesome. So, I don't know, I mean, it's all about like how damn good the movie is, right? I mean, a good movie can make up for the, you know, more cheesy special effects. I mean, look at like the first Terminator, which I just didn't even care. Like that, you know, the Terminator, you know, looked kind of fake in the end. You know, that's just like such a damn good movie. That's actually some art I should do, some Terminator art on that first movie. You know, come with me if you want to live. Greatest fucking line in a movie ever. Or one of them. Yeah, so much complicated stuff in this. I'm just like, yeah, I guess, you know, I don't know why I picked this one. But I don't know. I just wanted to see it. It just caught my fancy, and I was like, yeah, I want to paint that. So it's kind of like the Marilyn Monroe piece. And they did it bigger. I don't know if you guys noticed, but it's actually. It's the same size as that Maleficent thing I did the other day. And that's actually, I think it's about ready to end on eBay. It might actually end tonight while I'm drawing this. But yeah, anybody still wants it? I noticed there's a bunch of watches on it, so I don't know if they're all buyers or they're actually just other artists watching what I'm doing. I think I'm getting a few of that kind of stuff happening, which can kind of confuse like what I'm looking at, but that's totally fine. If you're like wanting to learn and stuff like that, I think, yeah, watch what I'm doing. Not to be cocky or anything, but just, that's how I learned to sell and stuff. Watching Mike Hoffman, he was like a hero to me, really. I liked Mike Hoffman's work, though, because, you know, I was like a Frazetta fan, and I think a lot of people disliked his work because of, he was kind of a, you know, some people said he's a Frazetta ripoff and stuff, and, you know, he's influenced by Frazetta, sure, but there's a lot of people influenced by Frazetta. I mean, Dave Stevens and Bernie Wrightson and a lot of my favorite artists. And on the other side of that is it's like, you know, Frazetta really just didn't paint hardly anymore for a lot of the years of his at the end of his life. You know, very little work came out. And I just like to see what Mike did, you know. Being inspired by him. But he was one of them. There's other guys now on eBay that I've been watching that just I've been learning stuff from. Who's what am I thinking of? Probably won't say his name right. Well, maybe I should save that till I look, but it's like Shelton Bryant or something like that. If you go into the link section on my site, go down to where it says eBayers, that's like where I kind of keep track of a lot of people. But he paints a lot of superhero stuff, sells like a ton of stuff, and it's impressive, you know. It's impressive watching what the guy does, how much he makes. I mean, and all I'm getting from that is just what he's making on eBay, which I know is probably not all of his money, but it's definitely, you know. And I was thinking about it the other day, and you know, it's kind of like once I said I was quitting my job and everything, I got a lot of suggestions of, you know, how to make it, and it kind of, you know, it's like the stuff that I've tried forever and just haven't been able to make work. It's kind of like if you're going to do sci-fi, fantasy, or whatever, then you have to be published, you have to be a book cover artist, you have to be movie posters, or book covers, like I said, or concept design, or, you know, work toy design for movies or something. And, you know, kind of had a plan going in to kind of just keep doing what I was doing, only just do more of it. Which my plan really didn't include any of that stuff. And, you know, I think I even said it at the beginning, approach it more like a fine artist. And, like, I think I tried to answer that question. I don't know if I really did it good to somebody who asked, but in the sense that, like, a fine artist, for example, like, if you're a landscape artist, nobody's really, you know what I mean? That's a great example, actually, if you're doing it in landscapes. I mean, there's a million people doing landscapes, or painting flowers, let's say, and hanging in a gallery. Same thing. There's a million ladies setting up still lifes, painting flowers, and selling in galleries, you know, for the last 150 years, you know. It's a very normal thing to do, and there's a bunch of them on eBay, I'm sure. And nobody really kind of blinks an eye that they do that. And they sell. If somebody's like doing landscapes, nobody goes, oh, you know, you can't do landscapes. It's like, that's I don't know, nobody just has a problem with it. It's just accepted. So, I mean, what's the difference if I want to just paint a bunch of movie art and sell it, you know? I don't know. Don't answer that. It's like, every time I say anything, I notice I get comments from people on my site and emails where they kind of like fervently agree or disagree with every fucking thing I say, and I don't know. I mean, it's just not really necessary, you know. I appreciate the comments and stuff, but I mean, you don't really have to agree with my opinion by any means. And if you disagree with it, I mean, that's completely fine, you know. If you want to, you know, fire up the webcam and record your own art video and with your, you know, your point of view on this kind of stuff. Not that I want to see it or argue with anybody, but, you know, that's probably the thing to do rather than email me and tell me what's wrong with what I'm doing. Because, you know, I don't know. I don't really care so much if anybody disagrees with it. I'm too damn busy trying to pay my rent this month, so. I do appreciate the comments, though. Every time I say something like that, I feel really bad because it's like everybody does do cool, you know, great comments and just, you know, wants to know this or that. And, you know, I'm not talking to you, you know, it's like, I'm not complaining about those comments. I totally don't mind talking about, you know, eBay or sketch cards or anything that people want to know, or, you know, like my last video, trying to show, talk about drawing or gestures, like that, those are questions I've had. I really appreciate that kind of stuff, but I mean, like in the last one, somebody made a comment, you know, I was talking about seeing a Matt Bush video, and how Matt Bush does the construction lines, and I said something like, you know, I think that's a bunch of bullshit, and so then, you know, just immediately just jumps all over me, because I insulted, you know, his hero Matt Bush, and it's just like, for Christ's sake, it's just my opinion, you know what I mean? I can't have a freaking opinion just because I'm on YouTube, like, talking. Yeah. No, I get so defensive, but I just, I don't know what the heck people expect out there. I remember there was like a point with Mike Hoffman where he was on the Frazetta boards and stuff. He'd just get a lot of hate on there, and there'd just be people just bitching and moaning about how he's, you know, copying Frazetta, and just, you know, would go on and on, and, you know, he'd get mad and, like, defend himself, you know, and, and then it would just feed the fire, you know what I mean? Which I guess, you know, maybe a guy should just be quiet and not, you know, when people are being trolls or whatever, you should just kind of be like, oh, who cares? Ignore them and, you know, just be about your thing. Because I know it's like the second you talk to them, and that's what kind of sucks, is now I mentioned that stupid comment in this video. And, it just spurs whoever makes it into leaving another one, you know? Which it's like, I didn't even want to care about reading the first one. I'm not really going to care about the second one, and I'm sure all that's going to make him mad and, you know, whatever. But, yeah, with, like, Mike, I think he had a hard time. Which is, like, all that. And it's like, he's just trying to paint and make his money, you know? And I never could understand those guys on the Frazetta forum. They just seem to, I mean, I just couldn't understand why they just was like, I mean, if you don't like Mike Hoffman's work, why do you look at it? Why don't you just go away? And I shouldn't even have brought that up either, actually, because I wouldn't want to stir up anything for Mike. You know. Eventually, he just stopped answering his comments, and that's I think all you can do is just kind of
ignore it.
So. Anyway, what else? I guess that could be a video right there. I wish I would have talked a little bit more about Planet of the Apes and less about the haters on YouTube and stuff, but whatever, I guess, you know, it's just going to be what it's going to be. Thanks for everybody who has been watching my videos and liking them and all that kind of stuff. I don't know. If you want to support me, hit eBay, buy something. Check my store, buy something. I don't know. If you want to get on Patreon, that's an option too. And I don't know. This one will probably be up today. Probably with the post, so you guys can see it. And, I appreciate it, guys. So, thank you very much. See you next time.